فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. As it's the norms of the scholars, when they want to go through a book, they would always talk about the biography of the author of that book. And the book that we're going to start with in the Kareem is called Nawaqidh al-Islam, The Nullifiers of Islam, and the book is written by Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah ta'ala. So it's necessary that we have an idea of who he is and understand a bit about his biography alayhi rahmatullah. In reality, my beloved brothers and sisters, the biography of Al-Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab is actually considered a practical example of the application of Salafi on this earth. That is, today we read in books of Aqidah what a Salafi needs to believe, or a person from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah should believe. But you may ask yourself at times, what would the application be on this earth? How would Salafiyah manifest on this earth? Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah تعد مثالا حيا واقعيا قريبا لما يعرف اليوم بالطريقة السلفية. The path that a Salafi should take. Should he lobby into politics? Should he fight his way through everything and kill innocent women and children? Should he? Or should he sit down and educate the people and teach them the Tawheed and purify them from shirk and nurture them upon Tawheed and eradicate and get rid of shirk? Is that the path that he should take? Maybe we look together. Which is it that he needs to do? Without a shadow of a doubt, it's the later one. That we need to educate the people, we need to teach the people, we need to teach them the two most important things, At-Tawheed al-Sunnah and the obedience of Allah and His Messenger. And the thing that we need to warn them against is Al-Shirk wal-Bid'ah, Shirk and innovation. And once that is done, it could lead to, and it could bring about, and it will inshallah ta'ala, bring about tamkeen for the believers. Allah making them steadfast on this earth and making them the upper hand over their enemies. Now some people nowadays will look at that and say, that is a joke, that can even happen. By sitting in the masjid and teaching books, and sitting in the masjid and educating the people, are you really serious? Do you think that's going to bring back al-majd wal-izzah, honor for the believers again? Here's an example, inshallah, for that. A person who did take that path, who did do that, who made sure that what he taught the people was aslul usul, the fundamentals of their religion, and he did bring about honor for the Muslims. So Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, studying him is actually studying the application of as-salafiyya. And that this does not just remain as nadariyya, a theoretical thing. Before we start the biography of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab himself, we have to speak about the environment and the type of place that he came to, where he came, and how was the Arabian Peninsula before the birth of the Sheikh. As we all know, Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he was born when the year was 1115. And Jaziratul Arab at that particular time as the scholars who were there and were alive at that particular time spoke about, like Hussein ibn Ghannam al-Ahsa'i. He's a very famous al-Mu'arrakh al-Shaheed. He's a very famous historian who lived at that particular time. And he is an individual, Hussein ibn Ghannam al-Ahsa'i, was an individual who became affected by the da'wah of Sheikh Muhammad Abdul Wahhab. He lived through it, rahimahullah ta'ala. So what he did was he wrote the history that took place at that time, how the Arabian Peninsula was prior to the da'wah of the Sheikh, rahimahullah rahmatul wasi'ah. Many others also spoke about the Arabian Peninsula, and even at that time how Yemen was as well. And Imam Amir al-Sad'ani, Muhammad Amir al-Sad'ani, the author of the Kitab Subul al-Salam, Sheikh Bulugh al-Maram, Amir al-Sad'ani also spoke about the Arabian Peninsula and how its situation was. Because Muhammad Amir al-Sad'ani is more of a senior to Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, he's older than Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. Even though they did meet each other in timing, they met each other in timing, but of course Amir al-Sad'ani was older in age. Also from the scholars who spoke about the Arabian Peninsula and how it was before the da'wah of Sheikh Muhammad Abdul Wahhab was Hussein al-Nu'mi. Hussein al-Nu'mi is from the ulama of Yemen. Also, all of those which I mentioned, Hussein al-Ghannam al-Ihsa'i and Muhammad Amir al-Sad'ani and Hussein al-Nu'mi, all of them, they all mention that the situation of the people at that time prior to the da'wah Sheikh Muhammad Abdul Wahhab was intishar al-shirk wal-dalalat, the spread of shirk and the spread of misguidance. Major shirk spread, especially la sima fi jazirat al-Arab, especially in the Arabian Peninsula. People were worshipping, domes. People were worshipping shrines and they had domes that they made, stones and rocks. People went back to the pre-Islamic time. They went back to Jahiliyyah again. People were worshipping qibab, they were worshipping ahjar, they were worshipping ashjar. Even the people were worshipping individuals. At that time, the Majani, the crazy ones, they claimed al-wilaya. They claimed al-wilaya, meaning they claimed that they are ilah, or they are awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They claimed that they were awliya of Allah. Magicians, fortune tellers spread. And of course, this was not exclusive to the Arabian Peninsula alone. It wasn't specific to them. Other countries in the world shared that with them. And this actually was spreading even more at the later stages of Ad-Dawla Al-Uthmaniyya, the Ottoman Empire. The Ottoman Empire at its later stages, it never used to give importance to Aqeedah and Tawheed in the first place, but it got worse as time went on. And at the later stages of the Dawla Al-Uthmaniyya, they actually started to what? They started to spread al-Turuq al-Sufiyya, Sufism, al-Bid'ah, al-Dalalat, misguidance, and etc. The place that the Sheikh Rahimahullah was born, Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, alone that particular place that he was from, which was Uyayna, there were 17 trees, تُقْصَدُ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ, that were called unto besides Allah, that the people would worship. This is a place that the Shaykh was born. And that place used to have a famous qibab, which was very well known in Jazirat al-Arab. Jazirat al-Arab had one qibab, it had one shrine that there was no other shrine like it. And this was the one, it was the Qubba of Zayd ibn al-Khattab, Umar ibn al-Khattab's brother. It used to be in a place called Jubayrah. This was the biggest shrine that they had.
It is أكبر القباب والأضرحة that the people used to go to and intend and worship besides Allah. And they used to ask, they used to seek refuge in Zayd ibn al-Khattab. Even in a place called Manfuha, there was a Fahlu Nakhlin, mashhurun yusamma Fahlu al-Fuhul. There's another shrine called Fahlu al-Fuhul. And the women who couldn't have children, the awanis, the women who couldn't have children, they would go to those places and they would, or the women who were single, sorry. The women who were single, they would go there and they would ask for a husband. They would say, Ya فحل الفحول أريد زوجا قبل الحول. Oh, فحل الفحول, I want a husband before the two year cycle goes by. I want a husband, give me a husband. Dir'iyah, which is the place that the author, rahimahullah, Shaykh Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, was. As I said, it had how many trees? 17. From them is Maqam Taj al-A'ma. The people used to come to this shrine. There was even a cave that Awat ilayhi Amira, a princess went into, and then the people started to, a princess went into this cave. So what they did was they started to go to that cave. They called it Kahful Amira. They used to also take that as a, they used to worship that as well. There was a Qubbatul Dirar ibn al-Azwar, which was in Sha'b Ghubayra. All of these things is what gives you an idea of the time and the way the people were living. And that this was a fatra, muzlima, a darkened era, a darkened time. Shirk had spread. Worshipping besides Allah was spreading, and it spread. So the Shaykh rahimahullah, he spoke about this in his books and in his works. And also the scholars that I mentioned, they also spoke about all of this. So even his grandchildren, they spoke about these things. They knew that these things were happening. His grandchildren. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, his name is Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab ibn Sulaiman ibn Ali al-Tamimi al-Hanbali al-Najdi. The scholars, they spoke about the biography of the Sheikh. And the best person who spoke about his biography and gave the best history and a biography about the author, rahimahullah, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, is Mu'arrikh al-Ahsa, the historian of Ahsa. His name is Hussein ibn Ghannam al-Ahsa'i, rahimahullahu ta'ala. He has a kitab called Tariq Najd. And of course the name is longer than that, the book's name is longer than that, but it's short for Tariq Najd. If you take the first volume of that kitab, Tariq Najd, the first volume, he only speaks about the tarjama of the Sheikh, nothing else. He just talks about, the first volume is only about Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. And Hussein ibn Ghannam al-Ahsa'i was actually with the Shaykh. He was close with the Shaykh. And the Shaykh, rahimahullah, requested from him. The Shaykh asked him. Hussein ibn Ghannam al-Ahsa'i, he asked him if he could actually write the biography of the Shaykh. And not only that, the history and things that are happening. Because the Shaykh was very sharp. He could see that people were going to make up lies against him. So he made sure that the incidents and everything that had happened was documented. It was written, rahimahullah. And Hussein ibn Ghannam al-Ahsa'i, he was from the people who gave victory to the Sheikh's da'wah. He was affected by that da'wah. And he made sure that the tariq was written. A lot of the people who talk about the biography of the Sheikh haven't read this book. They read orientalist books. And then they judge Muhammad Abdul Wahhab based on that. Also from the people who wrote about the biography of the Shaykh is Uthman ibn Bishr, rahimahullah. He has a kitab called Unwan al-Majd. He spoke about it in that book of his. Also, the scholars that spoke about the da'wah of the Shaykh and the Shaykh himself and gave us a bit about who he was, is his own children and his offspring. The A'immatu da'wah al-Najdiyah, the scholars that had come out from his legacy and his works. So if you go to the kitab Ad-Durar al-Saniyah, you will find in the kitab Ad-Durar al-Saniyah the A'imatul Da'wah in Najdiyah, what they mentioned about the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala. So there are many places that you can see from him. Even Al-Imam al-Shawkani, Muhammad ibn Ali al-Shawkani, who is the student of Muhammad Amir al-San'ani, he also spoke about it. Also that even the famous Egyptian historian, Jabarti, he also talked about the tarikh and the biography of the author, the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, Shaykh Muhammad Abdul Ham, and the da'wah of the Shaykh rahimahullah. As I said before, the Shaykh was born when the year was 1115 Hijriah. He was born in a place called Balda. His Balda was Uyayna. That's where he was born, which is a place very close to Riyadh. Very close to Riyadh. And it is 70 kilometers from Riyadh right now. The Shaykh rahimahullah, as it's well known, he took knowledge from his father, number one. His father was Qadi, he was a judge of Uyayna. And his grandfather was an alim that he would be called his grandfather. His grandfather was called Mufti Diyari Najdiya. That's the name that his grandfather had, which is the Mufti of all of Najd. One of the elite scholars of that time, one of the most famous scholars of that time, Hassan al-Tamimi, he took the Shaykh under his wing. He took the Shaykh under his wing and he made sure he educated and taught him. Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, قَدْ ذَهَرَتْ عَلَيْهِ عَلَامَاتُ النَّجَابَةِ. At a very young age, signs of amazement, unique characteristics started to show from him at a very early stage in his life. The Shaykh rahimahullah was excessively in love with the works of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. He would read those works. He would read the works of Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah. And Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab was kana had al-dhihn. His brain was sharp and it was strong. Mufratan fi al-dhaka. His mind and his intelligence was profound and his IQ level was high. Rahimahullah. Allah opened for Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab many sciences. And the knowledge of the religion, Allah opened a lot for him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed him to really love and give time to tafsir and kutub al-sunnah and hadith and fiqh. The Shaykh looked into all of those. And the Shaykh rahimahullah, he looked at the people of his time. He looked at the current situation of the people of his time. Rahimahullah. And he realized, أَكْثَرَ مَا يَرَاهُ مِنْ هَذِهِ الْأَحْوَالِ. He saw that the majority of the things that he sees that his people are in are مُخَالِفٌ لِمَا جَاءَ فِي الْكِتَابِ وَالسُّنَّةِ, is in opposition to that which the Kitab and the Sunnah has come with. And the Shaykh found that majority of the people in which he had found كانوا على خلاف ما أمر الله عز وجل, are in opposition to that which Allah commanded. In what? In some branches? لا. He saw that they were in opposition to what Allah commanded في أصل الأصول, in the most fundamental thing of the religion. في توحيد الله وإفراده بالعبادة. That they were in opposition to Allah's command in Tawheed and singling Allah in Ibadah. And the Shaykh rahimahullah, he was one who would revise these issues and would discuss these issues excessively. He would talk about it. He would bring it to the people's attentions. He even discussed this with his father and he brought it to his father's attention. And many discussions took place between him and his father. When the Shaykh reached 18 years of age, as it was mentioned by his Hafid grandson, Shaykh Abdul Rahman ibn Hassan ibn Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, as he mentioned, that the Shaykh went to do Hajj to the house of Allah. He was 18 years of age. The Shaykh made the decision of going to do Hajj. When he came to Hajj, he begged and he supplicated. At this moment, going to Hajj, he had a decision in his heart, which is to call to Allah. That was a decision he made. So when he went to the, and this of course made, the reason why he chose to do da'wah, and he chose to stand up to do da'wah, is because of the dalal, the misguidance, and the jahl, the ignorance, that he saw very common amongst the people. So when he came to the Kaaba, he stood between al-ruknu wal-bab. And he begged and he lifted his hands up in the air, and he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give him the ability, that Allah strengthens him. وَأَنْ يَشْرَحَ لَهُ صُدُورَ النَّاسِ. And he also asked Allah that Allah opens the people's hearts for him, and that Allah aids him in conveying his da'wah. And you have to imagine, he's only 18 years of age. And you need to ask yourselves, what are our 18-year-olds doing now? This is how he was thinking. He had this himma al-aliyah. He had this high aspiration. At the age of 18, the shaykh wants to place on his shoulders the guiding of these people. And he sees that he wants to take them out of the dhulumat, the darknesses that they're in, and the misguidance that they're upon, to the light of Tawheed and Sunnah. But the shaykh knew that that can't be done. That a person can't go out and educate other people and teach other people if he himself doesn't have anything. So the shaykh realized that, he knew that. As they say, فَاقِدُ شَيْءٍ لَا يُعْطِي. One who doesn't have, can't give. So the shaykh embarked on seeking knowledge and meeting the ulama and revising with the scholars. And he went to many places in the Muslim world. He went to Ahsa, he went to Iraq, he went to Mecca, he went to Medina, and he benefited from the scholars of those places he went to. He truly benefited from two noble scholars in Medina, two great ulama'alimaini kabiraini, two big scholars in Medina, which he benefited from. The first one is the great Indian scholar, Muhammad Hayat al-Sindi. Muhammad Abdul Wahab benefited from Muhammad Hayat Sindi. And he benefited because Muhammad Hayat Sindi was from the min al muhaddithin al kibar. Muhammad Hayat Sindi was from the senior and the elite scholars of hadith of that time. And Muhammad Hayat Sindi's aqidah was in line with aqidah Ahli Sunnah wal Jama'ah before even Muhammad Abdul Wahab embarked on his da'wah. And da'wah al salafiyya and da'wah al tawheed was already present in India. India had already, they already had da'wah salafiyya and da'wah ahli sunnah wal jama'ah still going on in India at that time. But we will speak about it later, why many people were calling to tawheed, like Hussein al-Nu'mi and Muhammad Amir al-San'ani and many scholars of in India, why they didn't succeed. Why were their da'wah not as effective as the da'wah of Muhammad Abdul? We'll speak about that inshaAllah ta'ala. The second person which he benefited from in Medina was Abdullah ibn Ibrahim ibn Saif al-Najdi in Medina, who was from the great scholars of that time as well. The Shaykh rahimahullah, he traveled to Basra. Every single place that he went to, Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab istafada fihi, istafada minhu, he would benefit from that place. And he would benefit from the scholars of that place. And he would also leave with that, he would leave that land with books. He would leave with books that they he would take from them. When the Shaykh rahimahullah came to Ahsa, he stayed with a man by the name of Muhammad ibn Fayruz. And with Muhammad ibn Fayruz were the books of Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab. So the Shaykh, what he did was he took many of the books from him. And the way that the books would be taken from someone is not that you can take the original copy. You would have to rewrite from the original copy. You would have to rewrite it fully. So the Shaykh, he copied from Muhammad ibn Fayruz the books of Shaykh al-Islam. But this individual, Muhammad ibn Fayruz, he became asbaha ba'da dalika min aladdi a'da'i Shaykh. He became from the greatest, he became the staunch enemies of the Shaykh. He became the mortal enemies of the Shaykh. He wanted to see the Shaykh rahimahullah go. So he became aladhi a'da'i da'wati al-Shaykh lama zaharat. When the da'wah of the Shaykh became clear, he showed enmity and hate towards the Shaykh. The Shaykh's brain and his knowledge and his quwwah, in his proofs, are present in his works. The Shaykh, he authored the Kitab al-Tawheed, which today is a umda fit tadris al-jami'at. Universities you go to, these are the books that are taught. You go to circles of knowledge, this book is taught. The Shaykh authored Kitab al-Tawheed, which is a umda, it's a backbone. It's a backbone for a person of the Sunnah. It's a backbone for a person who holds on to Aqidat Ahli Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Backbone for them. The Shaykh authored this in Basra. He authored it in Basra. وَكَانَ عُمْرُهُ أَلَى ذَاكَ And his age at that time was 25 سَنَةً 25 years of age. He authored this book, rahimahullah. He was only 25 years of age. And events and things took place in front of the Shaykh, rahimahullah, due to this. These journeys that the Shaykh embarked on, in which he took, and he's traveling, and the lessons and the benefits that he was given to the community, without a shadow of a doubt, the Shaykh was harmed because of it. The book he wrote, he got harmed for that. When he was in Basra, he had durus and lessons that were going on. He got harmed for that. And he did not reach the age of 25, rahimahullah. He's at 25. حتى انتشرت سيته في جزيرة العربية. His name, his reputation is being spoken about in corners in, of the Arabian Peninsula. People are speaking about a young boy, 25 years. He's called Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab. انتشرت سيته. وأصبح الناس, the people started to speak about him, talk about him. And they would speak about him as a young boy, a fresh student of knowledge. That's what they would refer to him. Who refuses and rejects the evil that the people are upon in worshipping the dead, the calling and the supplicating of other than Allah, looking for barakah in rocks and stones and trees. And this man, this young boy, he calls to ta'zeem al-kitab wa sunnah, venerating and glorifying the book of Allah, honoring the evidences when they're brought to you, following the textual evidences, tarku taqleed, stay away from blind following, and anything like that. So the Shaykh rahimahullah, فانتشرت سيته وجرت له أحداث رحمه الله. The Shaykh rahimahullah, his name, his reputation, his honor, it spread amongst the people. When the year was 1139, after the Shaykh rahimahullah, he came from Basra. He came to Uyayna. He came from Basra and the Shaykh came to Uyayna. He found that his father had a conflict with the leader of Uyayna. The leader of Uyayna and the father of the Shaykh, Muhammad Abdullah's father, they basically had a problem and a conflict. So his father left Uyayna. And his father went to Huraybila. So when his father went to this place, Huraybila, then Muhammad Abdul Wahab would have to go with his father. So he went with his father in Huraybila when the year was 1140. And they stayed and remained in Huraybila. The Shaykh busied himself in knowledge, educating the people, sending letters, writing to scholars of the neighboring cities and the neighboring villages. He would write to them. The Shaykh did not hear of any scholar whatsoever, wherever he may be, except he tried to write a letter to him in the Jazirat al-Arab. He would speak to them about these issues. And the Shaykh would give a lot of importance by bringing evidences for what he said. He would bring nusus from the Kitab and the Sunnah and the Athar al-Salaf. He would bring textual evidences from the Kitab. He would bring textual evidences from the Sunnah. He would bring proofs from the statement of the Salaf and the positions of the Salaf. The Shaykh, he gave a lot of i'tina, consideration to the textual evidences that were transmitted to us from the Salaf. He used to give a lot of importance to that. And of course, you guys are all going to see that in his works. The Shaykh was somebody who they used to be amazed with how he could do istihbar of evidences. Like how he could bring the Qala Allah and Qala Rasul as soon as he needed it. He became مثار استغرابا, somebody they became amazed with and fascinated with, because his memorization was sharp. He knew his evidences. Every issue that he held a position in, he knew who agreed with him on this. So he used to write to them. He would debunk their doubts that they would bring to him, rahimahullah ta'ala. When the year was 1153 Hijriya, the Shaykh's father passed away. And so when your father dies, you always know that this leaves a vacuum for people to come and harm you. So what happened was, the people of Huraymila, they started to benefit from this opportunity. So they started to harm the Shaykh.